Merry Christmas. Man, it feels so good to be able to say that here on this Christmas day. We're glad to have you in worship with us this morning, or today, I should say. We're just glad to be able to worship and to celebrate the birth of Jesus with you. Welcome to Atonement's Christmas Day service. We're doing it as this online service, and we are going to be blessed to have some music by the very talented music director here at Atonement, Mr. Evan Arsenault. Feel free to go ahead and sing along, as some of the hymns he has chosen are very well-known Christmas carols, Christmas hymns that you should be able to sing as he plays and as he sings. We're so glad to have you in worship with us this day, this great day of celebration, this great day of joy, of life, of salvation. And we begin our Christmas Day service in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And we continue with our first hymn. Part of any service, we now take a moment for confession and absolution. The way that we're going to do that this Christmas day is that I'm going to give you a moment to spend in private confession, to take some time between you and God, to confess your sins to Him. And we take a moment now. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called ordained servant of Christ, announce the grace of God to you, forgive you all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And as is custom here at Atonement, upon receiving again God's grace and God's forgiveness, we then take a moment and share His peace with one another. So I invite you to share the Christmas peace with those who you're worshiping with. I share God's peace. God's peace be with you. And we now continue with prayer. We pray, Almighty God, grant that the birth of your only begotten Son in the flesh may set us free from the bondage of sin. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Our scripture reading for this Christmas day is from Matthew chapter 2, beginning with the first verse. Now, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, saying, where is he who is born king of the Jews? For we saw his star as it when it rose, and have come to worship him. When Herod the king heard this, he was troubled, and all of Jerusalem with him. And assembling all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Christ was to be born. They told him, in Bethlehem of Judea, For so it is written by the prophet, and you, O Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel. Then Herod summoned the wise men secretly and ascertained from them what time the star had appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, go and search diligently for the child. And when you have found him, bring me word that I too may come and worship him. After listening to the king, they went on their way, and behold, the star that they had seen when it rose before them came at rest over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced exceedingly with great joy. And going into the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they fell down and worshiped him. Then, opening their treasures, they offered him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they departed to their own country by another way. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. We now continue our service with our hymn of the day. God's grace, God's mercy, and God's peace be with each and every one of you. Amen. Let's say it again. Let's say it together. I say to you, Merry Christmas. Man, doesn't it feel good to say that? And as we gather together on this Christmas day, we continue our series that we started at the very beginning of Advent, that series that was correlated and intertwined with our joyous sounds that's been focused on that beautiful verse from John's Gospel, John chapter 1, verse 5, the light shines in the darkness. And as we continue thinking about the way that God uses light to proclaim himself, to share his message, as we look at it in the scriptures, as we look at it in life today, we're kind of cheating a little bit. We're jumping ahead to Epiphany, which we'll celebrate again in January, because we're talking about the Christmas star. You know what I'm talking about, right? That star that the wise men saw in the east and that they followed until they got to Jesus. And again, you've heard me say this once, twice, multiple times. Quick disclaimer, this is not Hallmark. The wise men were not there on that very first Christmas day. But even though they weren't there, the star was. Because the moment that Christ was born, that star was birthed in the sky, God placed it there to be a beacon of light pointing the way to Jesus. Because that's what God does. That's what the scriptures do. They point us to Jesus ever since the beginning. We see that everything is pointing towards Jesus. We saw when we first started this series how God spoke light into being, and at that very first day of creation, that was created. But even before that, we saw where God is triune, a Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So they were all there. Jesus was there at the very beginning. And we see how just into the third chapter of the scriptures, again, we're pointed to Jesus. As we see in the midst of the fall and the sin, humanity's fall and disgrace, we see where there's that gospel promise that there'll be enmity between Satan and Eve's offspring. And even though Satan will strike the heel, Eve's offspring, who we know as Jesus, would crush his head. And then we travel throughout the scriptures, throughout the Old Testament, we see where there's prophecy and prophecy. There is Christ figure after Christ figure, everything pointing to Jesus, pointing to the fact that God would send someone who would reconcile his people to be with him, who would bring back and restore the relationship that was lost in Eden, and that he would make it clear so that there'd be no ifs, ands, or buts. No, are you sure, or what ifs? But that it would be all about Jesus, pointing to him. And so as we hear the story of the wise men, we don't get lost in just the fact that there are these men from far away, these men who brought gifts, and then they have this interaction with Herod. We focus today on the star that shines, the star that points. Here's Jesus. It's all about him. And on this day, as many of us are gathered with family and friends, and maybe already you've torn into the presence, and it looks like a war zone of wrapping paper shards and ribbons and bows. It gets so easy to get lost in the good things, right? It's great to get gifts. It's wonderful to be able to spend time with family and friends. It's great to finally have a day off and to relax, to take it easy, to get a good home-cooked meal. And all those things are wonderful and fantastic. We need them. But in the midst of it all, it's all about Jesus. The light shines, the star shines, and in the midst of all the distractions of worldly needs and a census and God's people who had forgotten about the promises and hidden desires to harm and to even kill, the light continues to shine. Jesus continues to be the focal point. And so I encourage and I invite you to join me as we gather in celebration, as we gather with loved ones, as we partake in the joys of this day, that we keep our focus on Jesus, the one who came as the child in swaddling cloth lying in a manger, the one who would grow, who would go about proclaiming the gospel, who would proclaim the forgiveness of sins, who would restore and heal, who would bring back to life, who he himself would give of his own life and rise again so you and I could be restored into that relationship with God, so that you and I could have comfort and assurance when we hear those words, your sins are forgiven. So you and I could know the great magnitude of his love. Let's keep that our focus, not just today, tomorrow, but for all eternity. And so as we wind down tonight, after all the celebrations, after all of the cookies and the eating and the joy, as we prepare to unplug that Christmas tree, turn off those lights one last time, may they remind us that it's all about Jesus. Amen. I invite you to join me now in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we just pray that you would continue to bless our Christmas celebrations. Lord, we thank you for the family and the friends that we are gathered with, for those who are unable to be with us, for all the many blessings that you've given to us in our life. Lord, we pray especially a prayer of thanksgiving and of joy for your son, Jesus, the greatest gift that you have given to your people. Help us to always keep him at the forefront of our minds. Help us to then showcase and share his love and his joy with all whom we may come across. And we now pray as he himself has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We now conclude our service with our final hymn.
Tell it on the